and welcome to this afternoon's edition of Terra Verde, a weekly environment program on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley and KFCF in Fresno. I'm Maureen Nandini Mitra, the host and producer of today's show. Well, I don't know about all of you out there, but boy, I'm so glad it's Friday. With all that's been going on, with the wildfires, the Delta variant, and kids back in school, and with this heartbreaking, chaotic situation in Afghanistan, it sure has been hell of a week. And I've really been looking forward to taking some time out and sitting down with a good drink this evening, as I'm sure many of you are as well. But at least for me, there's now a rub in that too. You know, even though I'm an environmental journalist, I didn't put much thought into the environmental footprint of alcoholic drinks. Or maybe it's because I didn't want to. That is, until I came across Shana Farrell's new book, A Good Drink in Pursuit of Sustainable Spirits. A writer, oral historian, and former bartender, Shana clearly did ponder on this question a lot. And that led her into an exploration of the spirits industry. She looked at everything from where the grains for our most popular bourbons come from, how they are grown, to the energy used in distilling spirits, and to the huge volume of trash bars generate. And she looked at possible solutions to these as well. Good thing I have Shana with me here today to walk us through some of her findings. Shana, welcome to Terra Verde.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm happy to be here.
Great. Well, to start off, can you give us a little bit of an intro of what got you interested in this subject?
Yeah, absolutely. So I spent many years working in the service industry, about 15 total. I started when I was in college and then started working at a bar in part of Brooklyn when I was in graduate school, and started to think a little bit more deeply about where drinks come from and how the ingredients that go into them are sourced. And during that time I was in graduate school, I was studying water pollution and sort of the socioeconomic environmental consequences of water pollution. And so I was kind of tying these things together. I was in grad school studying the Hudson River and how the pollution has affected the water. And there is a distillery there that is along the Hudson River. And so I interviewed them for my oral history master's and started to make all these connections. So that's kind of how I got interested.
Right. You know, in your book, you write, while we may insist on organic, locally grown produce, we have yet to engage with spirits at the same level. Why do you think that is so?
There's a lot of reasons, I think. One is that, you know, I think alcohol is sort of an afterthought. I think some of these things tie back to prohibition, where there was a stigma around it. You don't need alcohol to survive. You do need food, though. So we all eat. We don't all drink. And so sometimes I think that furthers the divide between the food and beverage conversation. I also think there are reasons, you know, in wine, we can go to the vineyards where the grapes are grown. And in food, we can go to the farms and see where crops are grown that end up on our dinner tables. But it's much harder to do that with spirits because a lot of times the ingredients aren't grown next door to the distillery. So there is that, there's a geographic disconnect. And then there's also regulation issues. So alcohol is not regulated in the same way that food is. And they're governed by two different regulatory agencies, the Food and Drug Administration and then the TTB for alcohol. So there's quite a few reasons, and I kind of dig into that in A Good Drink.
Right. And you also touch upon like how, you know, there is quite a bit of sort of industrialization in the spirit industry. And you point to one particular corporation in your book, the Midwest Grain Products. Could you tell us a little bit about that company and also about how the industry has a huge footprint?
Yeah, so with whiskey in particular, usually it's grown, the corn that's used to go into the whiskey is yellow dent, and that is considered a commodity crop because it grows in abundance, and it has, I mean, there's also the the chemical properties that make up it, it's good for alcohol, but it's also really consistent. And, you know, it, again, it grows in abundance in the Midwest. And so there's, I think with the industrialization of farming, corn is a really good example of how this gets swept up into the beverage industry. And there is a company in the Midwest that is really, really big. They don't allow people to visit, and there's a lot of, well, there's a lack of transparency around kind of what goes on, but they source ingredients like corn, and then they make different alcohol, like different whiskeys and alcohol products, and then they sell it to some distillery. So they're kind of like the middle person involved. And that also, I think, contributes to the divide between food and drink in terms of the environmental side of things. There's also a lot of, in terms of the footprint, there's a lot of issues that go into transportation and water usage. It's pretty much unknown how much water is used. It's hard to quantify how much water gets used to produce spirits. So that's another thing that's lost within the chain. But some ingredients get shipped over from around the world. Some get trucked in. Some get flown in. So it's really hard to really understand the impact of what the carbon footprint is. And then you have the packaging issues as well, and wood and forest deforestation, the wood harvesting that go into everything too. So there's a component that contributes to the carbon footprint definitely along every step of the way. And that's something that I go through in the book.
Right. What I was curious about, and you know, many people would probably not know, is that companies like Midwest Grain Products kind of supply a lot of the whiskey to, as I think you mentioned in your book, more than 50 whiskey brands. So, and then, you know, maybe you could give us a little overview of what then differentiates the whiskeys from this one mass-produced whiskey. How, what makes it different in different brands?
Yeah, I think with whiskey in particular, a lot of enthusiasts are really interested in the aging component and the flavor that the wood imparts on the alcohol during the aging process. There's a lot less attention paid to the flavor that the ingredients impart, and this largely goes back to the yellow dent corn, because many, many distilleries are using the same type. So there's not a lot that's being imparted specifically from the grain that's making it different, but the wood and the aging component. So that's why you hear a lot of distilleries talk about how they're aging things, or what the climate is for the rickhouses where barrels are being stored while they're aging. But I kind of argue that it makes a big difference about where the ingredients come from, and that should be part of the conversation and not... It just seems with the aging component that everything before that gets left out. So that's where a lot of the, when distilleries or companies are sourcing their alcohol from that particular company, they're trying to differentiate themselves between maybe the wood they use or how it's aged.
Right. Yeah, that's really interesting. There's one more line in your book that I found really intriguing. You wrote, "If my only choice is Campari, I'll order a different drink." Can you explain why?
Yeah. First of all, I have to say that I do. I love the flavor of Campari and Negroni. It's one of the main ingredients in a Negroni cocktail. Negronis are one of my favorite drinks. However, I don't love that there's additives that go into Campari. Many years ago, Campari was actually dyed naturally with a cochineal beetle, and that's where it got its red color that it's really known for. But as the industry got more industrialized, they started to use red dye number 40. And if you've ever drank Campari, it is a pretty viscous liqueur. And a lot of that texture comes from additives like high fructose corn syrup. So I prefer to have my Negronis with something that's naturally made that doesn't have those additives in it. There's a number of brands on the market that I really enjoy. St. George makes one that's their Bruto that's delicious in a Negroni. Cappelletti has one that's also dyed naturally with the cochineal beetles. And Yeah, so it's things, you know, I wouldn't want to eat red dye number 40 in food that I'm consuming, and so I'm trying to apply the same principles to drinks as well. So that's where the Campari conversation comes in.
Right. So you say there are things we have in some of our drinks which we are unaware of that we wouldn't tolerate in our food, right? Could you give us, what you said, high fructose corn syrup, red dye number 40. Could you give us some examples of what else is there that, you know, in some of these drinks that we should be thinking about?
Yeah, I mean, I think anything that's a synthetic food additive is something to be aware of. And that goes back to the regulation that I mentioned earlier. So alcohol is regulated by the TTB and food's regulated by the FDA. However, alcohol does kind of follow under one of the section of the FDA called generally recognized as safe. There's more information in the book without getting too much in the weeds about that. But there are certain food dyes and additives that are allowed in both food and beverages. The way that alcohol is regulated on the label, there doesn't necessarily have to be an ingredient list. So there's less transparency about what's going into a bottle of alcohol versus what's going into your cornflakes or your pasta sauce or something like that. And that kind of furthers the divide. But there are, I mean, this can be a little bit tricky to find because companies don't have to, if it falls under that generally recognized as safe ingredient list, they don't have to disclose what they're putting out there. So one thing that might be surprising to learn is that petroleum also goes into alcohol. Well, it can show up. It doesn't always. But petroleum is considered a mineral oil, and that also petroleum-derived products are commonly used in a myriad of food colorings. So those, you know, those red dye number 40s, and chances are if you're drinking like a mint liqueur, that mint flavor came from a chemical additive that was developed in a lab. So it's just things like that to be aware of.
Wow, that's a kind of damper, I have to say. So why is it, you mentioned the Prohibition era being one of the sort of reasons why we still don't regulate alcohol as a food, right? Is there any chance, any movement, anything underway for that to actually change? I think one of the key lines in your book was that, you know, that we do not look at alcohol as a food product, even though it should be.
Yeah, I wish I had better news on that front, but I haven't actually heard a lot of people talking about changing the way it's regulated. The TTB is really like a tax regulation, a regulatory body. And so, you know, when the prohibition tie there is before 1920, alcohol was regulated on a federal level, but then when prohibition got repealed in 1933, alcohol was then on a state-by-state, regulated on a state-by-state basis. And you'd have to get all of the states to work together in tandem to kind of recognize these things. It is subject to the three-tier system, but that's more, again, sort of a tax-based system where a producer has to go through a distributor who then has to go to a retailer before it can reach a consumer. And so it's definitely less looking about the sourcing and more interested in like the business side of things. I wish there was more, but there's less interest in that right now. Hopefully things will change, but yeah.
Right. We'll come back to that. This is Maureen. You're tuned into Terra Verde, a weekly environment radio show on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley and KFCF in Fresno. Today, we are talking about the environmental impact of the spirits industry. With me is author and environmental historian Shana Farrell, whose book on this matter, A Good Drink, will hit bookstores next month. Coming back to the regulation part of it, so you're basically saying that it's kind of whatever change is going to be happening right now is going to be driven by consumer demand and by the industry itself, probably, and by the pressures that the environment puts on us, on the industry, in terms of water access and energy access, right?
It's possible. I hate to shift the burden to consumers solely because that feels like an unfair burden and really heavy to place on consumers, especially right. when there's a lack of awareness about all these things. I will say that there are a number of people who are increasingly thinking about the role that alcohol plays in the food system and thinking really thoughtfully about the waste they produce, about how they're sourcing things, about the carbon footprint that's going into either a bottle of alcohol or a cocktail or something like that. There are more conversations that are happening among bartenders and industry leaders about these kind of things. And so that's giving me a lot of hope without just burdening the consumer. But I do think that it will come from an industry-driven movement, whether that's on the supplier side, whether that's on the bartending side, whether that's on the retail side. Well, yeah.
Would you like to give us a few examples about, you know, cases that you came across, instances of companies or individuals who are doing some very interesting work on this?
Yeah, absolutely. So actually, each chapter in the book highlights a different category of spirit. It kind of sets up some of the environmental issues and the impact of spirit production on the environment. But it also looks at different people who are doing things well and creating a model for people to follow. There's kind of a lack of guidelines. If somebody wants to open a distillery and they want it to be environmentally friendly and sustainable, and there's kind of a lack of information for consumers who are interested in buying green products. One company in particular is based in South Carolina, and they're High Wire Distilling, and they make a bourbon called Jimmy Red Corn Bourbon, and it's really delicious. They work directly with farmers. They're doing great work. There's also the Leopold brothers who make many types of things, but also vodka and gin. And I think that they are very environmentally advanced. They've engineered their distillery, like every part of their distillery is in service of lowering their carbon footprint and their energy use. And it's a really wonderful thing to see. There's plenty of examples in each category, but I can go more into specifics because otherwise I'll keep waxing poetic on the people in the book.
Right. And people should actually read your book, right? So I did want to talk about energy and water use just a little bit more. In terms of energy use, what is the biggest energy draw in the spirits industry? And, you know, is it can that energy imprint be closed in? You do mention Leopold Brothers, who are based in Colorado, right?
Yes.
Who've been doing quite a bit of work on that.
Yeah, I feel like the carbon footprint comes from a few places. I think with the farming aspect and the growing of the ingredients, because that's its own thing that is pretty resource intensive. But then it's also the transportation of those ingredients. And then once the spirit is distilled and aged and ready to go and packaged and everything, it's got to get from the distillery to a distribution warehouse and then to the retailer and then to consumers. So throughout the course of a spirit's life, it makes many, many trips. And I think that adds a lot to the carbon footprint as well. But the other thing that doesn't get talked about a lot is water, and it's a pretty water-intensive process, and that, you know, applies to the growing of the crop. It applies to, you know, cooking and fermenting, and when you bottle a spirit, you actually put water in it as well to get it down to a proof level. And even in making the labels that go on to the bottles, and then you also have to clean everything. So it's a very water intensive product, I would say. Yeah, and I would say those are the big three things.
Right. I think when we spoke earlier, you'd mentioned that if you had managed to get more data on water use, you would have focused a large part of your book on that. And that was probably one of the premises with which you approached when you came up with the idea for the book, isn't it?
Yeah, I would have loved to look at how water flows through every single part of the process of distillation. But this book focuses a little bit more on people and like vignettes of different distillers and people involved in the industry. I don't know that it's hard to make water a character, I would say, but I think water is incredibly important. And I do in particular think in California, where we're dealing with issues of drought and fire, these are things that are really important to think about. One distillery that I have featured in the book, it's in our brandy chapter, is St. George Spirits. They've been making brandy since they started in 1982. And fire and drought are something that they have to think about a lot, whether that's in their personal lives or whether that's where they're for the orchards that are growing their pears, down to the water usage that they are trying to, you know, think about in terms of how to become more sustainable in the future.
Right. And they're based in the Bay Area, right?
Yeah. In Alameda. Their distillery is exactly in Alameda.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you do talk a little bit about the trickle-down effect of climate change that has implications for the industry on every level. And that one was definitely a good example of that. I do want to talk a little bit about the sort of product end side of it, about bars and the huge environmental footprint that bars also have in terms of, you know, usage of things they use. Could you explain that a little bit?
Yeah, the restaurant industry, the bar industry is pretty wasteful. I think that we're lucky in the Bay Area that we have citywide composting measures.
Right.
So it's easier, you know, I'm from the East Coast and that didn't really exist there. So we were, much of the country is just throwing out things. So if you're cutting a lime for something, the ends of the lime in many parts of the country are going to end up in the trash. So there's a couple of people that I feature in the book that were really thinking through the ingredients that go into making drinks and how you can get a second and third life out of them, whether that's dehydrating part of the lime that would normally get thrown out, or you're using coffee grounds to make something. This stuff is all part of what they're thinking about and creating resources for bartenders to think about the waste stream. And then there's another bar operator who is thinking about how the idea of sustainability and luxury can coexist, and you don't have to compromise one for the other. And that, I think, is part of why it hasn't been as widely, it hasn't been as interesting to people, because there's been a stigma against sustainability for a long time. I think that's changing, but there was this idea that if something's made sustainably, it can't be a luxury product. And so this one particular bar operator is really challenging that idea and thinking about sustainability, thinking about sourcing products, thinking about the ingredients that actually go into the cocktails and how you dispose of that waste in these high-end bars that you can now find all over, you know, in London and now in the United States.
Right. In terms of bars, I was really intrigued to learn that one of the more environmentally friendly practices included ditching fresh produce. And I guess that's because of the composting and just use and waste around fresh, limes and oranges and things like that?
Yeah, it doesn't all grow in the same season. And so there, you know, if you're wanting to get a lime during the time of year when limes don't grow, you might have to get it shipped from a different part of the world. And that's really intensive, environmentally intensive, like resource intensive. And then one common thing in cocktail bartending is that this idea that you drink with your eyes first. And so you want a drink to be really visually appealing. And that means having like the brightest mint or some sort of garnish that's not starting to brown around the edges. It might be perfectly fine, but it has a little brown. A lot of people just end up discarding that. There's so much waste. There's also a ton of water waste because you're using ice to make the drink and then you're dumping the ice out. You also have a intense amount of ice in your well where you're making the drink. And at the end of the night, if you haven't used all of that water, you have to dispose of it in order to clean. And so there are all these issues that I think come up.
That's so interesting. So one of the suggestions might be for us on the consumer end is maybe say, give me that cocktail without the garnish or the ice, right?
Yeah, I mean, that would be pretty cool if people were like, yeah, you know, I'd love that drink, but it would be okay to have it without a garnish. I think that would help. There are other ideas that people have, like pre-mixing drinks, and they put them in the refrigerator so it actually they're cold and they're already diluted with water, and you don't need ice to mix them. There's some really interesting things that are happening in terms of addressing water waste specifically.
Right. And I know, you know, you don't want to put the onus on the consumer end, but really we are part of the milieu, right? So if I go to the bar, go to a bar in downtown Berkeley this evening, you know, what can I do? You know, what how can I support the effort that some in the industry have already started, you know?
Yeah, I think one of the first things to do is homework before you go to the bar. I know that's not a great thing to do on a Friday night when you're looking to unwind, but it kind of does start with that. So, you know, you might want to look up your favorite gin brand and see, okay, what is their website telling me? Do they mention anything about sustainable practices? When you start to read about that, is there anything there? And then you could also maybe do a Google search for the thing for other companies that do things in a more sustainable way. I mean, I would be aware of greenwashing there, but to find out some of that stuff can be really useful. And then let's say like the Leopold Brothers make this gin that's really delicious called their summer gin. So you could go to the bar and you could ask for that specifically. And I do find that consumers have a lot of power when they're sitting at a bar asking for particular spirits. The bartenders are listening to that. And if something gets ordered over and over, they have incentive because they know people will want to order it so they can move it. And then you might want to ask, like, you know, if you want a Negroni, do you have an alternative to Campari that is available? Something like that. So just asking some informed questions. A lot of bartenders, unless they're specifically engaged in these issues, it's harder for them to know some of that stuff. So asking them like, hey, in that whiskey, where did that corn come from? They probably won't know the answer to that. So that's where I think doing the homework comes in on the consumer end.
Thanks for these tips. I really appreciate it. That's all we really have time for on today's show. But to learn more about Shanna and her work, go to shannaferrell.com, shannaferrell, FARRELL.com. And Shanna's new book will be out next month. It's called A Good Drink. Look it up. It's published by Island Press. Thanks to our engineer, Rod Akil, this show and others are available for you at your convenience online. Have a great weekend, everyone, and thank you, Shanna, for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
I decided to use this kind of analytical mind that I have. And I said, okay, wait a minute, let me think about this. I said, is there anything wrong with watermelons? No. Is there anything wrong with the watermelon man? Nope. That was my answer. There was nothing wrong. And so it was right then that I decided I have to stand up for what I believe in and what is right and what I feel, follow my heart. And there were even some musicians that, you know, when I told them I wrote this song called Watermelon Man, they said, you're not gonna call it Watermelon Man, are you? No, really, it was like that back then.
KPFA, storytelling for social change.